Without further ado, it is my great honor to introduce all of you to Dr. Ann Partridge, who, in addition to being the founder and director of Young and Strong, is also the vice chair of medical oncology, the director of adult survivorship at Dana-Farber Cancer Institute, and then also a professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. So thank you for being with us again tonight.
Thanks, Catherine. And again, thanks to you and Sarah Demaray, who's off camera, but very, very center and prominent in this whole month of events for our program for Young and Strong. So thanks for pulling this all together and getting us all here in the proverbial room. I'm thrilled to be here tonight with Dr. Stanton, who is, I'm going to tell you about her, but she's just a great person that will become evident, and she's all that in terms of her bio. So she's the distinguished professor and chair of the Department of Psychology at UCLA, which is one of the largest departments of psychology in the nation. She's also appointed in the UCLA Department of Psychiatry and Biobehavioral Sciences and the Cousin Center of Psychoneuroimmunology, and she's a member of the Johnson Comprehensive Cancer Center there at UCLA. Dr. Stanton's a licensed clinical psychologist. She's authored more than 250 publications, and this is probably old. There are probably hundreds more since then. I've had the pleasure of being able to collaborate with her, and she's just great. Through her research, she identifies factors that promote or impede psychological and physical health in adults and couples undergoing chronically stressful experiences. Sound like something familiar to all of you? She's got a focus on the experience of cancers of the breast, eye, pancreas, and lung, so breast, of course. And she translates her findings into action by developing and testing approaches to enhance well-being and health over the course of the cancer trajectory. I'm not going to read all of the things that she has done and all of the things she's served as president for and been in charge of and the grants she's been awarded. Just trust me, there are a lot of them because I'd rather us have the opportunity to hear from her as she gives us wisdom about too young for this, managing the emotional journey. Dr. Stanton?
Thanks so much, Dr. Partridge. It's really great to be here with you all tonight. I'm on the, as you know, I'm on the West Coast, so it's only our afternoon, but I'm delighted to be with you. And thank you also to Catherine and Sarah for supporting me as I tried to figure out my PowerPoint for the last 15 minutes. So I think I'm hoping that my screen is on, correct? If it's
you are
not.
Perfect. You're good.
Okay.
Perfect.
Great. Okay. So tonight I'd like to talk to you about some of what we've learned, not only in my lab, but in many others across the last several years about younger women coping with breast cancer. And I'll focus in on a few specific studies and also on a review we conducted. And I also, as Sarah mentioned and Dr. Partridge mentions, I'm a clinical health psychologist. And so that is what I'm trained in. And over the years, because I'm a licensed clinical psychologist, I also have had the honor really of working with young women with breast cancer clinically as they try to manage this emotional journey. And so I'll bring in some of what I've learned there too. And so tonight, basically my plan is to talk a little bit about my young women's psychological experience. And really, you are the expert in that. And so it's odd for me to be telling you about this, but what I'm interested in, and I think I'm hoping, is that you'll find some of yourself in what we found through the research. And then I'll talk a little bit about what we found helps and hinders young women as they manage the emotions of breast cancer. And then give you an example of a couple of effective approaches. And actually, Dr. Partridge doesn't know this, but I'm going to mention a trial that she was involved in very, very recently. So let's begin. First, in terms of terminology, this definition of survivorship by the Office of Cancer Survivorship, which started in 1996 And you see here a photo of when they were celebrating a decade of progress. Well, now it's been 25 years. And the Office of Cancer Survivorship in the National Cancer Institute defines survivor as an individual is considered a survivor from the time of diagnosis through the balance of his life. And also, survivorship is relevant for caregivers. Now, most women diagnosed with breast cancer do identify themselves as survivors, but not all like the word. And so I just want to say, if I use survivor tonight, I hope that you'll translate it into a word that is comfortable for you. I'm principal investigator of a fairly new research project that we call Project SOAR. And SOAR stands for Speaking Our African American Realities. And so we're interested particularly in Black women's experience of breast cancer. And just a few months ago, one of the women who is a younger woman who participated in our gatherings for Black women with breast cancer said, before I was diagnosed, I thought old women got breast cancer. And developmental psychologists call this a breast cancer in younger age. They call it an off-time event. Off-time events are those that don't correspond with typical developmental trajectories in adulthood. And so being diagnosed with breast cancer when you're young is simply an off-time event. Women who are diagnosed often don't know anybody else who's had breast cancer, who is their age. Perhaps they know people in their families and others who are older, but often don't know same age people who've been diagnosed with breast cancer. So in that way, it's an off-time event. And that connects with a number of consequences for women. Unfortunately, this morning, I learned that a young member of our research team, who's actually an undergraduate here at UCLA, she's 19 and she was just diagnosed with breast cancer. It was a shock to her. It was a shock to our team. And we wish her all the best and we'll be there for her during this time. But she was at a point when she's 19 of really just having the foundations, making a foundation of independence. She was living away from her family. She's decided to move back in with her family. She was forging a life on her own as an undergraduate student. And now she's going to begin to feel more dependent on her family. Fortunately, her family is very supportive. And so it's not a bad thing to go back and get that family support, but it does compromise potentially her sense of independence. And so younger women often feel that, especially particularly younger women, women in their teens or early 20s often have that sense of independence a little bit robbed from them when they're just really making strides toward it. Of course, you all know that employment can be impeded too. And last year, I heard a story of a woman who is a physician and worked in an academic medical center, much like UCLA's. And she got diagnosed with breast cancer in her 30s. She actually decided not to tell anyone at her hospital, at her academic medical center, that she was diagnosed because she was concerned that people would start looking at her in a particular way, looking at her as compromised. And so, and you'd think in the healthcare system, that kind of stigma wouldn't exist, but she was so concerned about it. And I think that stigma can be real, that her employment and her comfort in her employment really was impeded. You all also know that having breast cancer when you're young can change friendships. Your other friends aren't going through off-time events. They are making relationships, starting in careers, sometimes having babies, and and you watch your friends go through those normal on-time events, and that at least temporarily is not your life or is interrupted. And finally, of course, breast cancer at a young age can affect intimacy. Certainly we know, and I think you talked maybe last week about sexuality and breast cancer in younger women. And certainly we know that dating and intimate relationships can be affected. So that's just a thumbnail sketch of the kinds of things that are more specific to younger women's experience that older women who experience breast cancer at a so-called more normative time don't experience or don't experience as much. Islands here, this is off New Zealand and that has many, many islands. What we also know about breast cancer though, and this is true for both younger and older women, is that younger women often feel breast cancer doesn't completely overwhelm their lives, but there are what have been called by Barbara Anderson, another researcher in this area, islands of disruption. So certainly there's good evidence that during diagnosis and treatment, those tend to be the highest risk times for distress, depression, anxiety. And we see that in our own research. But also there can be difficulties when at the phase that we call reentry, that is when your primary treatments have been completed and you're sort of in some ways cut a little bit loose anyway from the medical system, and you put so much energy into really getting through treatment, focusing on that, focusing on your health, that many women feel a little bit adrift during the time when your medical appointments wane, you don't go in for radiation every day. And so reentry can be a difficult time too for some women. And then early survivorship, extended survivorship, those bring another particular kinds of issues. And then of course, some people experience recurrence and metastatic disease. We are going backwards. Okay, so given that special circumstance for younger women, what kind of effects does having breast cancer at a young age have on quality of life, anxiety, depression? We did a review that was published in the Journal of the National Cancer Institute about 10 years ago now. And I'll tell you a little bit about that. And over the past couple of weeks, have been really trying to update that. And the picture, unfortunately, really hasn't changed much in terms of psychological status of younger women. And so let me tell you a little bit about that review because it does seem to carry through to what we're seeing today. So during that review, we did a systematic review. That means just trying to find all the studies that had been published on the psychological status of younger women with breast cancer the past two decades. And there were hundreds of articles published on psychological well-being, psychological distress in the population of women total who had breast cancer. But we actually only found at that time 28 studies that really were methodologically sound and focused on younger women's experience. And by younger, you probably have talked about what younger means. I'm sure you've talked about that with your own physicians as well as this series. But we defined younger as less than 51 years of age. 51 years of age is the typical age for menopause, or women could be premenopausal. And there were only 28 studies. So younger women were understudied then. And we are finding out more in the past 10 years, but the themes are about the same. And so what we were interested in is comparing younger women with breast cancer, both with women their age who did not have breast cancer, so sort of norms for psychological status in women who were not diagnosed with cancer but were the same age. And then we also compared them to women, older women who did have breast cancer. What we found here were some consistent themes. And the difficult part of the journey is that younger women reported lower physical health-related quality of life and psychological quality of life. They reported experiencing more anxiety, more stress, more fear of cancer recurrence, and they had considerably higher depressive symptoms, either than age-matched comparison groups who did not have cancer or older women with breast cancer. So one of the things we've been interested in is what are the factors that contribute to that kind of picture of younger women with breast cancer. So one of the things we did was do a study that we called it the MAYA study, My Year After Cancer, and specifically breast cancer. And we got women as close to diagnosis as we possibly could. And so we recruited women for the study really as soon as we could after they got diagnosed, and then followed women over 7 assessments over the course of the next year. And we were really interested in having a fairly large sample. So these are 460 women from California and Arizona. On average, they were 56 years old. But here we were interested in a whole age range. So our youngest survivor was 23 years old and our oldest was 91 years old. And on average, women had been diagnosed only 2 months earlier. And the farthest out they could be was only 4 months. And so all of these women had been very recently diagnosed. About 20% of the sample were Latina and most were early stage breast cancer. What we're really interested in here are changeable coping strategies and strategies to regulate the emotions of breast cancer that were most important in these women and particularly important in predicting depressive symptoms and depression across the course of the year. So here our outcome was depression. There was no intervention in the study. And we had good retention, about 85% of the women stayed in the study. So if you just look at women overall, what you found is that on average, women weren't depressed at study entry at that 2 months, but were fairly close to a clinically suggestive cutoff for depression on this particular instrument, the CESD. 16 is the cutoff, and women had a score of about 14 on average, and they got better over that year. But that simple line really doesn't show you how women did when we think about variability of women's experience of depression. Here you see different trajectories of depressive symptoms across the course of that 12 months. What you see is about 43% of women really never had significant depressive symptoms. And they started just a tiny bit elevated on depressive symptoms and then decreased slightly over time. You also see that women had about 20% of women had very significant depressive symptoms initially, but recovered very, very well over time until they were really very much back to not having depressive symptoms after 12 months. You also see about 38% of women who were at risk for high depression and high levels of depression, and they really didn't get back to being non-depressed until about 16 months after the cancer diagnosis. Now, unfortunately, what we found here is that younger women were more likely to be in that high trajectory, or more likely to be in that 38%. But there are also women who were young women who were represented in the recovery trajectory and in the low trajectories, particularly in the recovery trajectory. So initially finding the cancer diagnosis very disturbing, but recovering really well over time from depressive symptoms. So So really what that says is younger women aren't all alike in their experience of breast cancer. They may be more at risk for depressive symptoms, anxiety, compromised quality of life, but it's really not a one-size-fits-all kind of experience. Younger women have a lot of variability among their own group of younger women with breast cancer. Now, then the important question is, okay, then who's going to do relatively well and who's not going to do so well when they are diagnosed with breast cancer, again, in younger women? And we have studied this question a lot because we want to find changeable kinds of behaviors, activities, thought processes, emotions that women can work on to be in that great recovery trajectory we saw in the previous slide. And so a lot of our research is focused on this question. So what we found, one of our very consistent findings and findings in other labs as well, is that women who try to consistently push thoughts and feelings about their breast cancer away from them, try not to think about it, try not to have emotions about it, try not to, often they don't talk about it, really constrain themselves when they think about the emotions, any thoughts, anything related to breast cancer, that does not bode well for adjustment across time. And so even prior to diagnosis at biopsy, women who are avoiding any thoughts that they might get diagnosed with cancer, that it might not be the outcome they want, they are more distressed after diagnosis if they try to push thoughts and feelings away even prior to their biopsy. Same thing from diagnosis to surgery, women who are trying to avoid after they've been diagnosed, and then after their surgery, it predicts not doing as well, having more anxiety, having more depressive symptoms. During that reentry phase that I just mentioned a minute ago, women who try to push thoughts and feelings away don't do as well during the reentry phase, during that first 6 months or so after their treatments are completed. And not our lab, but another researcher's lab has found that avoidance during that time of diagnosis and treatment can predict poor adjustment even 3 years later. We see this finding across both younger and older women. So it's not something that singles younger women out specifically, but it is something that seems to apply for both younger and older women. So if avoidance hinders women in their adjustment, in their recovery from depressive symptoms after their breast cancer diagnosis, what helps? What we and many others have found is that strategies designed to actively approach your experience, your emotional experience of breast cancer, predicts better adjustment across time. One of the key strategies is being able to seek and accept support from those friends who are willing and able to give you help, from your family, from your partner. Women who actively seek social support and especially emotional support from friends and family tend to do better across time. Finding benefit. It's interesting because younger women with breast cancer actually are more likely to find some benefit in their experience of breast cancer than our older women. And it may be because the breast cancer experience is off time for them, is more disruptive to them. And so it requires more, okay, what does this mean in my life? That kind of questioning. And what we find is that younger women with breast cancer are more likely to say, I really found out how strong I am. I really found out how good my relationships are. I really found out that I can do everything I can to be healthy, and I'm committed to that. I found out what my true priorities are in life. So younger women are actually more likely to find benefit than older women who were diagnosed with breast cancer. Actively accepting that one is diagnosed, that is sort of the opposite of avoidance, tends to predict better adjustment across time. Using spiritual coping also tends to predict better adjustment across time for women across ages. And specifically, what we found is that it's not being tied to a particular religion, but to have a belief system that brings you meaning in life, and to have a belief system that's comforting. So a belief system that gives you peace in life. That kind of reliance on spirituality does tend to predict better recovery in terms of emotions across time. Engaging in problem-focused coping, that also can predict better adjustment, and particularly when young women find things that they can't control. Okay, well, they can't control that they got breast cancer, but they can control getting a second opinion. They can control getting the kinds of supports they need. There's things that they can control, and women who focus more on what they can control and do that kind of problem solving around those issues are likely to do better than women who don't have the same kind of problem solving skills. And then something that we've been particularly interested in is what I call coping through emotional approach. And that is women who really do actively engage in the emotions they're feeling and actively try to figure out what they're feeling, try to figure out what that means, and expressing their emotions in some ways. And there can be different ways to express your emotions, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Oh, that was my glass half full. Strange order, but you see that young women are more likely to find benefit. Okay, so these are slides to just show you it, sort of graphically, what we found in our study with 460 women who were diagnosed with breast cancer across that first year that I just told you about. And here what we find, these are the women who remained high in depressive symptoms across that first year. What we see here is that women who are higher on avoidance and women who really didn't decrease much in their avoidance, even across a full year's time, they still were trying to push their thoughts and feelings about their experience out of their head and out of their heart. Those women were less likely to recover from depression and more depressive symptoms and more likely to stay in that persistently high depressive symptoms group. We also see this is a composite of approach-oriented strategies, seeking social support, emotional expression, finding benefit. And here, these are the women who recovered from depressive symptoms across the course of a year. And the women who recovered were more likely to use those kinds of approach-oriented active engagement strategies that we just discussed. And there were two particular strategies that seemed most important for the women in helping them in their emotional recovery with regard to depressive symptoms. The first was coping through emotional expression. And I mean here emotional expression, particularly about their breast cancer experience. So women who talk to friends or family, maybe a trusted confidant about their breast cancer experience, this is this dotted line here. Those women who actually increase their emotional expression about their experience over the course of the year were the ones who were most likely to recover from depressive symptoms. So emotional expression seemed to be one of the most important approach-oriented strategies. Another important approach-oriented strategy was active acceptance. And here what we see is, again, the women who were likely to recover from depressive symptoms, they were the ones whose acceptance of the reality of them having been diagnosed with and treated for breast cancer increased over the course of the year. So again, emotional expression and acceptance seem to be the two primary strategies that helped women, if they were able to stay with them and even increase on those kinds of coping strategies across that first year after breast cancer. Those were the women who did the best in terms of recovery from initially very high depressive symptoms. Okay, so in my last, looks like 10 minutes or so, I'd like to talk about some effective approaches for addressing those kinds of engagement-oriented strategies that we've just talked about, and helping women not need to avoid their deepest thoughts and their feelings about their breast cancer experience. So first, I want to talk to you a little bit about Project Connect Online. This was a randomized controlled trial that we published some years ago, and it was not specifically targeted to young women, but I think that I can't say for sure that the trial is specifically relevant for younger women, but my clinical experience suggests that it is. So let's see what happened in this trial, Project Connect. We were particularly interested in the interpersonal challenges that women experience after breast cancer. And one obviously is managing the emotions of the experience. And one thing that's important interpersonally there are, do you have even one or two friends or family who can tolerate the tough emotions, not maybe try to fix them, but just be with you as you experience the emotions that fear, depression, the emotions you're experiencing. We also were really interested in whether we can maximize social support from family and friends, because what we know in our research and others' research is that social support tends to erode after the primary treatment ends. So after surgery, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, social support tends to erode because people expect you to start getting back to your life. We were also interested in managing communication during breast cancer, because what we had heard from lots of women, what I had heard for years, is that often it wasn't easy, sometimes, especially if women had big social networks, that there were all kinds of friends and family who wanted to know how they were. And it wasn't easy to manage all that communication or just to tell the story over and over again. And finally, the other thing we heard from women, old and young alike, was that breast cancer sometimes was the first time that women had thought about asking for help. One woman said, "Giving help is easy for me." She supported her partner, she supported her young children, she supported her friends, but asking for help was very hard. Asking for help, even accepting help when it's offered, was difficult. And so sometimes this is the first time that women really think about accepting help. And so we were interested in developing an intervention that might help women with all of those interpersonal challenges when they were diagnosed with breast cancer. My inspiration for this, and this is a picture by consent of the two women, were two twins, Dana and Tracy. And Dana is an executive in a tech company. And when her twin sister, Tracy, developed breast cancer, Dana started a website for Tracy for just the reasons we talked about just this past slide in terms of the interpersonal challenges. So she started a website to help Tracy manage her experience. Some years later, When Dana got diagnosed with breast cancer, Tracy did exactly the same thing. And so they are my inspiration for Project Connect. Some of you probably have been on Caring Bridge. This is a public site that allows you to communicate with your social network about your where you are with your cancer journey or other diseases as well. And some of you, my bet is some people in the audience have been on Caring Bridge. But those kinds of communication strategies had never been tested. And so we decided we wanted to test what helping women build a website, a personal website to communicate with friends and family after they were diagnosed with breast cancer, would it be helpful or not? And so we compared it to a waiting list control. So women either were offered Project Connect initially or after the trial had completed. And we did 3-hour workshops with anywhere from 3 to 5 women per group. Each woman had a computer that we provided. And at the end of the workshop, they had built a website for communicating about their breast cancer experience. They got a take-home manual. They got technological support. They could have a friend or family member be with them in the workshop to help. And so after this 3 to 5 hours, women had created their own personal website to communicate about their breast cancer experience. There were 88 participants. On average, they were 56, but there were young women in this trial, 28 to 76 years. And I'm going to show you just a few of the websites. So the centerpiece of the website was the I call it a journal. People would call it a blog. And it was women talked about whatever they wanted to talk about their breast cancer experience. Women had completely free choice in talking about whatever they wanted to talk about. They also had a How You Can Help page that their friends and family who viewed their website women could say, okay, I need, the survivor could say, I need help taking my 3-year-old to daycare on these 3 days. I need help. I need somebody to drive me to chemotherapy. There was a calendar and also other ways for friends and family to help. They also had a link. And so women often provided links to the National Cancer Institute, the American Cancer Society, Living Beyond Breast Cancer, that organization, so that their friends and family could learn about their treatment and about breast cancer. And the people could subscribe to updates. So these were private sites. People in the women's circles had to be invited specifically by the woman, and then they could get automatic updates when the woman posted. Here's another view of this is another woman's website. And here's another woman's website called Bumps to Triumphs. So women created their own personal websites. Women were so invested, we found, that they also wanted to see other survivors' websites who participated in Project Connect. And so we made a web page for them so that they could look at their other website, the other women involved in the trial's websites too. This is the kind of thing that women said, and we found that women often were very emotionally expressive in their journals that were on their websites. The pain that was not the cancer, but a life unexpectedly in shambles. Now that my status, and going down to the next one, now that my status is cancer patient, I guess I will consider help. So women really wrote about what they were thinking and feeling about their experience. We asked women, how were the websites useful? Initially, they thought they'd be useful before they built their own website. They thought they'd be useful primarily for letting other people know how they were doing. But after having done the website and built it and 3 months later, women said really they were most useful as a place to express their emotions and a place to tell their stories. So they became a vehicle to manage this emotional journey that we're talking about this evening. We also ask visitors. There was a place that visitors could participate in this study as well. We found that mostly it was friends and extended family who logged onto the website, and very primarily people, friends and family who logged onto the website were women themselves. And women, the visitors to the website said that it was most useful providing an update on the author's health, providing an update on how they're doing emotionally, and helping the visitors feel close to the author of the website, because they were often across the country and sometimes across the globe from the women who were creating the website. So what did we find? What did we find in terms of the effects on emotions and other kinds of psychological outcomes? We find, compared to the control condition, Project Connect Online improved women's positive mood. So Project Connect Online, PCO, we call it, participants improved their positive mood over 6 months. They also, some effects were women were specific to women who were currently in medical treatment. The Project Connect Online seemed most effective for women who were actually in treatment. And what we see here is that women who were undergoing chemotherapy and radiation therapy, in general, they had an increase in depressive symptoms. Women who were in Project Connect showed a slight decrease, but mostly they were protected from that increase. So women in Project Connect did much better with regard to depressive symptoms over 6 months. Similarly, they also showed pretty dramatically reduced negative mood across that 6 months of treatment compared to the other women who were in treatment who did not get Project Connect. How did it work? Well, women who were in Project Connect increased in their coping self-confidence. They felt more able to cope. They specifically felt social support from their friends. And that's interesting because that was the people who primarily visited their websites were their friends. And they showed a decline in loneliness. And those three factors were the ones that helped women with regard to depressive symptoms. We also found that women who used more positive emotion words in their journals, in their blogs, had more positive mood 6 months later, and women who used more negative emotion words actually had a decline in depressive symptoms 6 months later. So actively expressing negative emotions helped in terms of reducing depressive symptoms 6 months later. I also want to just give a nod, and I'll finish here in a moment, but to mindfulness meditation. This is with Dr. Partridge and my colleague, Julie Bauer, and I was involved in what I call trial one. Dr. Partridge is involved in trial two. And in this randomized controlled trials, we gave women a 6 week mindfulness meditation intervention that focused on attentional focus to the present moment and non-judgmental awareness, an openly accepting attitude to one's experience, whatever one was feeling. So women got 6 weeks of mindfulness training. In the first trial, they had a waiting list control. In the second trial, they actually had survivorship education. So they either were assigned to mindfulness meditation or survivorship education over these years. On average, these trials were targeted specifically to younger women with breast cancer. And so on average, women were 46 or 45 when they entered the trial. They had been diagnosed anywhere from about 2.5 to 4 years ago on average. So they, on average, were in their early 40s when they were diagnosed, but certainly it spanned the range. But all of the women were younger women with breast cancer in both of these trials. What were the findings? Well, in the trial one, we found that mindfulness, as compared to the waiting list control, reduced women's perceived stress, increased their sleep quality and reduced their fatigue, decreased their hot flashes and night sweats, increased their positive mood, and increased that sense of meaning and purpose and peace in life that I talked about before. 3 months later, women who were in mindfulness increased, improved in terms of their fear for cancer recurrence, it had declined, as well as those intrusive thoughts about cancer. That's what happened 3 months later. In trial two that just was published in the Journal of Clinical Oncology in August, and Dr. Partridge is a co-author on this article, mindfulness again improved depressive symptoms and fatigue and insomnia right after the intervention. And 6 months later, the researchers saw both an improvement in depressive symptoms that was sustained for the mindfulness group in comparison to the education group, in comparison to the weightless control condition, improvements on fatigue and insomnia, and improvements on hot flashes and night sweats. So I think we're seeing, especially in these last trials, findings that are targeted specifically to young women that are very promising in terms of their findings. So basically, what are we saying here? Well, for young women, it's a challenging emotional journey. Consistent findings show that women who are younger are more at risk for depressive symptoms, anxiety, fear of recurrence. We find that avoidance tends to increase distress and depressive symptoms across time in younger women. We find that approach-oriented coping, seeking social support, expressing emotion, actively accepting your own experience tends to decrease distress, depressive symptoms, anxiety. We know, though, that one size does not fit all. Women, even among younger women, have different experiences, and we really need to think about what's best for whom in terms of how we can most effectively bolster the emotional journey, lead to lower rates of depression, lower rates of anxiety, more finding meaning and peace and benefit. And we're finding now that effective resources are increasingly available, in part because of the kind of research I've talked about with you today. So that is pretty much what I wanted to say. I have such wonderful collaborators. These are part, some of my students and postdocs. I have wonderful collaborators, including Dr. Partridge. We have collaborated very specifically on adherence to endocrine therapy, but also are collaborating now. The funding agencies that I mentioned before. And I would love to have a discussion with Dr. Partridge and take any questions.
Thanks, Annette. I'll call you Dr. Stanton again.
No, please call me. Please call me Annette.
That was really terrific. And I wish, you know, when it's a large crowd, we have to do the webinars style. I wish you could see everybody's faces who's listening, because I am 100% confident they are clapping and cheering right now, and what you're saying resonates with them, because I know a lot of the people on.
I wish so, I could too.
That's right. You know, it's hard not to be.
It's so weird not to talk to faces.
I'm glad we can have each other, right? We can see each other.
Exactly.
It's hard not to see you all, but we're here for you all. And please put your questions in the Q&A. Some people did start doing that. But I want to start with, you know, everything you're saying obviously resonates with me, having cared for many young women with breast cancer over the years. And this whole program is designed to try to get at some of the things that you obviously highlighted in your talk from the psychosocial standpoint, not only addressing the medical needs, but helping women to come together to support each other. And we can talk more about that. So thank you so much for doing it. All right, so let's start with the first question that came in from Nicole. Given we're all in a very stressful situation, how do you distinguish between anticipated normal levels of stress and anxiety? When should people seek additional help, counseling, or medication? So what's just kind of normal adjustment that it'll settle down versus I really need some help here?
That's a really good question. And my first response is there is no set dividing line. So it's not as if, you know, okay, this this level of depression, you absolutely need to seek help for. This level of depression, you don't. What we see in almost all women is you know, getting diagnosed with cancer is distressing. And so distress is really normal. Very low levels of distress are much more prominent in older women than in younger women. So especially for the women you see, Anne, the you know, distress is just the normative experience. I'd say that there are a couple of ways that we can think about when it's really time to seek help. And let me also say one thing before that, and that is, what we know is that from our research, like in the 460 women study, what we know is that most women actually get better with their existing support structure, their medical team, their family and friends, their spirituality. So most women actually don't seek formal psychological help. And they, after about a year after diagnosis, they are tending to do pretty darn well. There are actually some what we call prospective studies. So women, you compare the sample even before they were diagnosed with cancer and then follow them for a long time. And after a year or two, after a cancer diagnosis, a breast cancer diagnosis specifically, most people are really sort of getting back to where they were before. Some people even thrive in the context because they found out really what's so important to them, and they pursue that in a way that they maybe hadn't done before the cancer diagnosis. But the signs that I think it really is important to seek help are a few things. One is that if you're feeling high levels of anxiety that interfere with your daily living for more than a few weeks, if you're seeing very high levels of anxiety that really you don't want to go out, you don't want to do anything, you don't want to do any of the activities you used to enjoy, if you're feeling so depressed that you really don't want to get out of bed, so if those kinds of feelings are severe and they persist over more than a couple of weeks, then I think it really is important to talk to your oncologist, to talk to, you know, you have built a really wonderful team. So it's not only, they don't only get you as an extraordinary oncologist, they get a whole team, a whole support team. And then it's really important to take advantage of that kind of more formal. So the severity of your anxiety, the severity of your depressive symptoms, and if they persist across time. We do know that especially for depression, that standard antidepressants can be successful, can be effective. And then the kinds of approaches we just talked about, or cognitive behavioral therapy, for example, can be very effective.
Thanks, Annette. I would say, you know, I would have a low threshold for saying reach out. If you're not sure that you need some help, the nice thing about the silver lining of the cancer journey is that, as Annette just alluded to, there are a lot of resources there for you. And you can pick and choose. And, you know, we have social workers that are at the ready, that if someone needs someone, if you're not sure, you know, just try it. And if it feels like it adds value, great. If it doesn't, you know, I don't think you have to be home in bed for 3 weeks before you have to ask for help.
That's, no.
You know, you're saying what's the extreme, but what I'm saying is the door is open here, and at least take advantage. And some people, I think, while it's a real trauma for most people to go through this, as Annette alluded to, some people are healthier in the long run psychologically because they do kind of embrace and deal with some of the things they haven't dealt with for a long time, or they feel good about what they got through. Again, I would never like tell someone you should be that way, but that does happen, right, Annette?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I completely am on board with what you said. Have a low threshold for it. I was talking about the extreme when you really absolutely need to get professional help. But the kinds of support services you all have, even if you're just feeling a little rocky, it's worth it to reach out.
Yeah. And I think we all can benefit from things like mindfulness personally. All right. So here's another question that came in. This is from Anonymous. Is there any research about whether cancer support groups are helpful to most people? Does it just depend on the individual woman? I find some aspects helpful, but also find hearing some stories such as recurrence or other bad outcomes to be very distressing. So I know you know a lot about this, Annette.
Yeah, I do. And there's a lot of research on for women with breast cancer. There's not a lot of research specific to younger women, except, for example, the mindfulness trials. But yes, support groups. So yes, we know they can be helpful. And we also know factors that make them more helpful. One is having an expert leader tends to help. And so someone who leads, who's a psychologist or a social worker, someone who really does know about the experience, someone who's trained in, therapy and working in groups. And so having a professional leader helps more. We also know that support groups are more helpful for some women than others. So for example, women who, and this is specific to breast cancer survivors, women who find that their partner, who have a partner, but they find their partner's not very supportive, going to a support group can really help. And so if you don't have, sort of an existing effective support structure, then a support group can really help. And so there's a lot of research. There are a lot of support groups that, of course, haven't been researched, but having an effective leader, when I conducted a support group for many years, and I led and a survivor led. And we were a team leading a cancer support group, and that seemed to be a nice connection. But I'll tell you what, there was a support group down the road from us, who the leader gave people a book and the book was called "You Can't Afford the Luxury of a Negative Thought." The idea was you can't think anything bad or the cancer will come back. It's wrong. There's no good evidence to support that. Two, it's a toxic message to people that they can't have negative feelings when they get diagnosed with cancer. And so there can be support groups that really do not work. If you join one, again, like Dr. Partridge says, try it. And if it's not working for you, find a different support group or find another way that will help.
And just to, there was another piece of that question that you kind of got on, but I just want to follow up on, which is, you're in support group, you like support group, and then there's a story of someone, it's a negative story. They had a recurrence. So what's some practical advice? That's going to happen, right? When you're supporting each other, sometimes that happens. What's your advice around any individual woman in that group? Not necessarily the woman with the recurrence, because obviously we got to help her too, but the person, the friends who are at risk also managing that.
Yep. It can be jarring. And it's also hard to talk about in the group. Because you hear someone's story and the person is not doing very well. They have a recurrence. And so that can be tough for the group members. I've been in and led some groups where we talk about that actively. And we honor, you know, also in long-term support groups, you have people sometimes who get so ill and they lose their lives. Those are hard issues. And one of the things we know, though, is being able to communicate about those issues can be really important. So when we lost a member in our support group, those of us who felt that we could, we went to the memorial service. We honored people in our memories, and we provided all the support we could to people who had recurrence. And it was tough. And it's hard to hear those stories. And sometimes that means that you talk about it openly in the group. And sometimes it means that you can get support from, you know, a partner or friend or professional on the side to deal with some of those feelings, because the feelings are completely natural.
Yeah, thank you. We actually have a separate related group. It's not separate from this. Some of the people in the group may be on this webinar, a group called Embracing Young and Strong, which is specifically a support group for it's a Zoom-based support group for our young women who are living with advanced disease.
Yep.
And I know that they have a whole process that Catherine and Sarah help run, along with one of our patient advocates, and three patients help run it to manage those kinds of issues. So, you know, it does unfortunately happen less and less, especially in, you know, breast cancer survivors, which is good. Most people will not succumb, but I think, you know, some of your thought, it's got, you know, you have to know whether it's right for you. That would be
absolutely important. Absolutely
to manage that. And sometimes that's at your point in time, right?
Yep. And different support groups are very different. And so you know, if you go into one that does not feel all that supportive or helpful, look for a different one.
All right, good advice. All right, so we have a lot more questions and we have some time, so that's good. All right, Rachel asks, what exercises were given to patients during the mindfulness trials that were helpful?
Well, Dr. Partridge may be able to comment on this, but the trial was specifically for younger women with breast cancer. And so some of it was about some of the exercises had to do with that it was basic kind of mindfulness meditation. And so the leaders guided women through the kind of attentional focus on breathing, gently bringing attention back to the breath. So that kind of attentional focus, and then non-judgmental awareness of whatever was experienced. And so, you know, maybe you, a feeling comes up that you hadn't expected. You feel really angry about having this experience. And so in mindfulness, the exercises that you observe that anger, you're curious about it, and you don't reject it. You sort of try to, you see it, you experience it, and you bring your attention. I'm using mindfulness kind of gestures here, but you bring your attention again back to the breath or a focal point. And so those are sort of the basic kind of techniques. And in these trials, they were applied specifically in that breast cancer context.
Yeah, and mindfulness is fantastic for a lot of things. It's been studied now in things like in cognitive behavioral therapy for a lot of symptoms and a lot of psychological issues. So I would refer everyone who's in the Boston area. We have the Zacum Center, which has mindfulness meditation skills training, actually, and sessions that are available through the website at Dana-Farber. And you can sign up for things. And there are ones through UCLA as well, right, Annette? You guys can, people can
yes.
sign up through. What's the center called again?
It's called the Mindful Awareness Research Center, MARC, M-A-R-C.
Right.
Yep. And we also have the Sims Mann Center for Integrative Oncology that cancer patients and their families in general can come and get free psychological support services.
Yeah, and a lot is available online. So do look online for those things.
Yes, and Mark does have, you know, 5-minute meditations that you can do. They're not specific to cancer, but they are, there are lots of resources available if you look at that center.
Yeah, that's good. All right, so Daryl says, can you speak to the emotional impact of hereditary cancer gene mutations and breast cancer survivorship? I'm in the reentry phase, yet will need ongoing screenings, multiple cancer risks, and I'm having difficulty feeling emotionally regulated around that.
Yeah. And this is true more for younger women than for older women, the surveillance after treatment is often more frequent, that sometimes treatment is a bit of a moving target. And so it's a more demanding setting. And so in terms of what we don't see in the research, actually, is that women who have genetic mutations, they don't seem to differ much in terms of psychological status from women who don't. And so it's having a mutation is not a risk factor for depression or anxiety. Because the sort of after treatment phase can be more complicated, then it sort of keeps you going more. It keeps you more into the process. And so basically having a place to address those thoughts and feelings, either through writing, through mindfulness meditation, through talking to friends, talking to professionals, having a place where you do allow yourself to focus on your emotions, and then, you know, having some freedom, having a place to focus and really dedicating some time to actually focus can then make the rest of your time a little bit freer. So making a place emotionally for your experience, and then, you know, not that you can ever completely let it go, but you can feel a little bit emotionally freer if you pay some attention to your emotions.
Good advice. All right. So is depression more common with ovarian suppression?
There is not good evidence that it is, but I have to say there's not much evidence. Yeah. That's my answer.
I'll start with that one too. Or address that one. I completely agree. Even in that landmark study, which compared tamoxifen to tamoxifen plus ovarian suppression to aromatase inhibition plus ovarian suppression, there were slightly higher rates of some depressive symptoms in the groups that got the ovarian suppression, but not, frank, necessarily greater levels of depression. Depression was, and this is all premenopausal women, so all young women.
Oh, good.
Depression across the board was about 4 or 5% in the whole group. People who hit, you know, at least, you know, filled out a survey, you know, it's not clinical depression necessarily, but the screen for depression, these surveys, it was about 4 or 5%, and it did not differ across the board with all of the things. So the short answer is, the evidence doesn't suggest it causes frank depression, but there may be some more depressive symptoms in women on ovarian suppression, which I know is not a very satisfying answer. And I think if someone needs it for their treatment, then we need to manage the depressive symptoms. Of course, if someone gets depression, I think if there's a borderline indication and it's pushing someone towards being more, having more symptoms, then you really need to consider it if it's not something you absolutely need to treat your cancer. And sometimes people say, I want to do everything, even when the indication is borderline. And that's one of the things that might weigh into the pros and cons. That's the way I tend to think about it. Even if something's not causal either, if you felt it when you went on that thing, you know, you can't ever like not attribute it to that. And you got to figure out how to manage the symptom and the problem. You want to speak to that?
Yes, absolutely. because if you're feeling it, then it's important. What we do in research, we're talking about group statistics. And, you know, that one size fits all, it doesn't fit all, applies here too. You know, even if the research shows that in general, you know, you might have some depressive symptoms, most are mild, not really sort of clinically depressed. If you're feeling depressed, that's important.
Right. And it may have been precipitated by going on ovarian suppression. So it doesn't, you know,
right.
So it could be causal. And so we, you know, I think it's important that you communicate that. All right. Next question. Is there any emphasis in the medical oncology field on paying special attention to the sensitivities of premenopausal women? I cried for a week when my first MO nonchalantly told me to shut it down my ovaries. And the nurse looked at me like an alien from outer space, not understanding why I would not want to do that. I had to shop. So this is a person who found that the medical practice, it didn't happen at Dana-Farber, by the way. So that's good to hear. Although I hope it doesn't happen at Dana-Farber, but every now and then people aren't going to be as sensitive. So what's your advice around meeting a not so sensitive professional? I know that we as professionals try to be as sensitive as possible and try not to take our bad days or our insensitivities out on our patients. I hope we most of the time get it right. But do you have advice for someone when they find that kind of environment?
In general. And that would be to I've seen women go a couple of different ways with that. One is to find somebody else. To find somebody else where you do feel understood and treated well. And so if you have that luxury, you know, if you live in a small town and you're driving, 2 hours to get to the only oncologist within the whole area, sometimes you don't have that luxury, but often women do have some choice. And so if you're not feeling supported by your medical team, see if there's somebody else. Another way that women go that seems to work pretty well is to realize that you're not going to get what you need emotionally. And you may even get some like looking at you like you're weird from your medical team. Don't ask them for that. Find your support someplace else. Know that they might not have the best bedside manner. Know that they might not understand the experience of young women. If you have the luxury to be treated at Dana-Farber, you know you have somebody who does, but sometimes you don't have that luxury. And so if it's a good oncologist, technically, if it's a good oncologist in terms of competence in treatment, sometimes you can stay with that, but know that you're not going to get what you need with emotional support there and get it someplace else.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. And I, you know, historically there have been lots of teams, and I'm sure this happens even in my practice, where I'm coming in and out making the recommendations, and then, you know, the PI I work with or the fellows doing more of the support of the social worker just because of time pressures.
Right.
So I would say, and tell me what you think of this, Annette, you know, I learn from my patients, and I'm not sure. I always appreciate if I've been or said something not quite right or something that didn't resonate, it's also okay to look and say, hey, you know, I'm really struggling with the idea of doing that for 5 years. I remember one of my colleagues used to just come in and say, you're going to get tamoxifen for 10 years and we'll probably suppress your ovaries and blah, blah, blah. And it was like a jail sentence people were feeling. It felt like they were being judged and sentenced.
Yep.
And I would say, you can't kind of say it like that. Like, you know, like, let's talk, you know, let's see how you do in the first, you know, yeah, we do it for 5 or 10 years, but we'll decide as you get there, we'll see how you do, because it felt so bad to people. And we, you know, and so that's how I tend to do it. But I learned that from my patients, because, you know, hearing all that, they would tell me that that's overwhelming. I mean, not everybody, but some.
Absolutely. And I think if you, you know, get up your courage, as the patient, you can give feedback. And I have seen it work. I've also seen it absolutely not work. And often, you know, you're in a vulnerable position. You've just been diagnosed with breast cancer and you know, you're going to give physicians feedback. Well, you know, they don't usually ask and the person may not be very open to feedback. So, I think absolutely. And I also would say, if you leave a practice for a particular reason, then they have no power over you, right? So you can write a letter and say, I've left and this is why I've left. And that may be listened to. Also, when you get good treatment and treatment that where you really feel supported, I'd say give that feedback too. Because a caring oncologist really appreciate it. And frankly, most of the oncologists I've worked with are incredibly caring. Sometimes they don't show it, but most of the oncologists are incredibly caring and they really do, they want to be responsive to feedback. Sometimes they haven't gotten it in their medical training, really how to be responsive. And you were open to that kind of feedback, but not everybody is.
And it's not easy to take it, I will say. So I hear you, the vulnerability and the kind of guts that it takes to do that. So maybe I'm unrealistic about saying to do that, but you can do that with me if you're mine. And many people are open to subtle ways of kind of saying, oh, that's really hard to hear. Do I really need, you know, maybe it's not being critical, but more just kind of acknowledging how painful, at least the subject we talked about of, you know, the insensitivity can feel.
Yeah.
All right. So there's a question about, we have about 10 minutes left, give or take. And there's a question that I think we talked a little bit about. Do any of these studies distinguish between women on endocrine therapy or those who are not?
I would say, well, for example, in our study, the one with the 460 women, we did not find that, you know, over the course of the year that being on endocrine therapy predicted depressive symptoms. I don't know whether any of the intervention trials have tried to understand effectiveness, psychological intervention trials have tried to understand effectiveness for women on or off endocrine therapy. So I think the answer is we don't know.
I don't think we do that. I do suspect though that it's a little similar to what you alluded to with the genetics folks, is that, you know, the symptom, you know, it's a gift that keeps on giving. And so while women with ER negative disease sometimes hope they had an endocrine therapy for further risk reduction, people who are taking the hormones, you know, I'm glad for them. They have something for risk reduction. And at the same time, I'm sure they are too, but they have to continue to see us a little more often and they have to deal with side effects and things like that. Yep. So I think that may lead to some more long-term, you know, feelings of symptoms and having to deal with it and not being able to move on in the same way. I know it does.
Yep. Absolutely.
You know, more, you know, I like to say Dana-Farber time. We like to give people Dana-Farber free time, but some of these things make you come back more often. All right. So there's this is a good question. So from whom should someone seek advice on antidepressant drugs? Is it better to seek out a psychiatrist who specializes in oncology, or, you know, how should people get good advice around that if they need it?
Yeah. If you are fortunate enough to be in a center that has a real psycho-oncology kind of center, so a support service, there could be a psychiatrist attached to that center. And that might be the best because that person is both a psychiatrist and so is trained in psychoactive medication, but also understands cancer and the cancer experience. And so that may be the absolute best. And then otherwise, you know, a psychiatrist who particularly is focused on depression is, I would say, probably the best person. Now, all of that said, there are many really good primary care people. There are many good oncologists who can either refer you to somebody, or primary care people can prescribe, obviously, primary care physicians obviously can prescribe themselves. So optimally, a psychiatrist who knows about the cancer experience next, psychiatrist who specializes in depression, and then sort of the other specialties.
Thank you. I'm going to synthesize another one because we only have a few more minutes. Anonymous writes that she's not getting the support she wants. And we can generalize this. She's feeling like her best friend is preoccupied with her own life. And even though she's promised support, and we see this. So people say they're there for you, and then they're kind of not there for you emotionally or physically. And I, especially in survivorship, I call this when the casseroles go away. And yes, the patient still feels like I'm suffering here, and everybody wants the world to go back to normal, or a person never really gave you much time, even though they said they would. How do you manage those relationships without losing your friends and your loved ones?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And we do see it, like, particularly in that reentry phase when support drops. But we also see it, you know, there, you find out about which friends are good for what. And so there are, even if it's your best friend, that best friend may be either so afraid that of your being sick, your having the diagnosis. She may be so concerned with, you know, she's focusing on having babies and you're going through, you know, menopausal symptoms. She may not know what to say. She may not know what to do. Some friends are better at, you know, being able to tolerate emotion. Some friends are better at bringing casseroles. And so I think that your cancer experience ends up informing you about which friends are good for what. And sometimes, if it's a very close loved one, sometimes it's worth trying to talk to the person because they may be afraid. You don't know quite why they're not spending the time that you think that they might. The only other thing I would say is that if you have even two or three, there's something called compassion fatigue. And we usually talk about it in medical professionals, but sometimes friends can feel, you know, they have a particular limit, and then they do end up sort of backing away a little bit. And sometimes it just makes sense to talk to, have a few different friends that you can talk to.
Spread the wealth. Yep. That's great. Well, the last question is a really good one. And I know I can comment on this too. Many young women are also parenting. Yep. What's the research about the impact of parenting during cancer on emotional outcomes, either as protective or a risk factor, and any advice around that?
Oh my gosh, that's a whole
long question. I know.
It's part two. it's a fantastic question. And there actually are good resources in your center, and probably has them, for how to talk to children about cancer. And it really depends on their developmental phase. And so, you know, very young children, you might use different language. Maybe introduce the topic, because children understand when a parent is sick. And so to not talk about it at all, you know, like, mystifies it. And so, but for very young children, you might say, yep, mommy's sick. She's going to be sort of sick about every month. But she's really working at, you know, she's really working at getting better. And the treatment makes her feel a little bad. So you can just, you know, that's just going to happen over the next couple of months. And when the child turns attention to something else, okay, I'm going to go play now. Okay, that's fine. You know, little bits of information in really simple language. Same thing, I did a group once with young adults whose moms had breast cancer. And what they said is they really wanted to their parents to be honest with them. This is what they have. Sometimes it's really good to have the whole family come into a support center, so that an expert in child psychology can help, or an expert in adolescence. Sometimes adolescents actively push you away, and sometimes that's because they're scared, and it's not easy. And so, yes, you definitely need, and I'd say, have a session on talking to kids about cancer.
Thank you. And we do actually have parenting workshops that we throw. So, yes. And we, our social works, I put in the chat, I answered some of the questions, not the chat, the Q&A, I answered some of the questions in the Q&A that we didn't get to where the answer was pretty straightforward, but we're at time. Annette, it's clear that we could spend a few more hours with you, but we need to, you know, it's 8 o'clock here. You probably need to go do some additional work. This is real work. It's a different kind, but there are many compliments about how much you know, your comments resonated with this group in the chat. And I'm gonna just read the beginning of one of them because I feel like it's just, and some parts of it. So one of the attendees wrote, "I don't know about any of you other ladies, but she seems to have touched on almost every emotional and psychological issue I am and have been experiencing. I felt very alone during this process of battling cancer." I'm going to cry, as I'm sure many of you have. "I have always steered away from peer groups, but I am happy that I have gone out of my comfort zone to participate. It really helps to hear from peers or guest speakers that others are feeling the same way as I am. It really validates my feelings. I feel understood here." So, and thank you for your comment.
You made my month. Thank you.
And lots of agreement with that. So
yeah,
so we'll stop there. We got to drop the mic.
Thank you. It's been a meaningful hour and a half, and I always love talking to you. So I really appreciate everybody's attention and all best wishes as you continue on this road.
Thank you, Annette.
Okay.
The best. Bye. Bye, guys. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, Catherine and Sarah.